Like so many people in the past 3 years, I've had the sad opportunity to think about death more than I ever did before the COVID lockdown, with the possible exception of just after Princess Diana died. Cousin Diana was born 2.5 weeks before I was, and I remember very clearly when I first heard about it, it was choir practice just before meeting on that Sunday, and Judy, you were the one who, yeah, I hadn't heard it before you mentioned it. I have to admit that I was rather uncomfortable for a while after she died so suddenly and spectacularly in 1997. When you are in your still in your 30s, and somebody who is that close a contemporary of yours, you know, suddenly is no longer there, that's a little unsettling. Some of you may know that in addition to being Easter, today would have been Joyce's 67th birthday, except that we lost her in August of 2020. Sometimes there isn't a day goes by when I don't miss her. Physicists used to debate whether light is particle, wave, or demonstrates properties of both. Grief, on the other hand, tends to behave more like waves, lapping at your heels, washing suddenly over you when you least expect it, in extreme circumstances threatening to swamp you. Or sometimes grief is more of an ambush predator, like a cat stalking its prey, lying in wait for you and then springing on you out of nowhere. Grief, as so many have observed, is the price we pay for love. In the ordinary course of things, we humans know, somewhere in the backs of our minds, that the day will eventually come when each of our loved ones will leave us, at least for a while, and that we, in our turn, will leave those who love us. In the face of this knowledge, which really seems to be unique to our kind, there is ultimately very little we can do. We can prolong life these days, but only for a time. And when our loved ones do inevitably leave us, we're left to figure out how to live around the holes they leave behind. Let us turn now to Luke chapter 24, verses 24, which is, of course, the first part of the story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. We have considered this passage more than once and from more than one angle. What I want to focus on today isn't about the unrecognized presence of the resurrected Jesus, although much can be and has been said about this aspect of the story. What I want us to look at right now is the response that Cleopas and his unnamed companion, who was probably his wife, give the unknown stranger, who turns out to be Jesus, of course. It is, at least initially, a grief response. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you're holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. We had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. And besides that, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. The stranger comes upon Cleopas and his wife as they're probably trudging along, discussing the recent happenings. That they are sad is mentioned explicitly in the text. The 17th century philosopher Blaise Pascal famously referred to the infinite abyss in the human soul, which can only be filled by God. At the outset of the Emmaus story, Cleopas and his wife are suffering from the sort of void which occurs when a loved one dies. At first, the stranger has to tease out the story from Cleopas and his wife, but once the details start flowing, they come pouring out. You can almost hear the two of them interrupting each other as their excitement mounts. After the stranger explains how all of this was necessary according to the scriptures and agrees to stay with them a while, Mr. and Mrs. Cleopas recognize the risen Christ when he blesses and breaks the matzah for the evening meal. We Christians tend to forget that this was still the middle of Passover. And as Jews, Cleopas and his wife weren't back to eating regular bread yet. No longer sad, they hurry back to Jerusalem to tell the apostles of their experience with the risen Christ. In the 18th book of the Antiquities of the Jews, written near the end of the first century by the Jewish historian Josephus, there's a passage known traditionally as the Testimonium Flavium. Although it clearly contains elements which were added by a Christian redactor, probably at some point in the 3rd century, the majority of scholars believe that there is an authentic kernel to the testimonium. One of the sentences usually accepted as genuine states that when Pilate had condemned him, Jesus, to the cross, those who loved him at the first did not forsake him. We don't stop loving someone just because that person has died, although we may be angry about our loss for a time. One of the comforts of the Christian faith is that our loved one hasn't stopped loving us either. Although we obviously can't be together in the same way now. Many churches speak of the communion of saints which transcends death. William Penn articulated a Quaker version of the same thing when he wrote in More Fruits of Solitude, a passage I like to call the Quaker link to Harry Potter, because it was in the front of the last novel. Death is but crossing the world, as friends do the seas. They live in one another still. For they must needs be present, and that love and live in that which is omnipresent. In this divine glass, they see face to face, and their converse is free as well as pure. This is the comfort of friends, that though they may be said to die, yet their friendship and society are, in the best sense, ever present because immortal. Our relationships evolve and unfold in the presence of God, whatever you understand God to be. And this underlines the principle that our relationships are meant to be holy, are meant to be incarnations of love. To quote from 1 John 4, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and those who love are born of God and know God. Those who do not love do not know God, for God is love. In this the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. We love because God first loved us." Every year, as part of my preparation for Easter, I revisit one of the great Jewish stories, the sojourn in Egypt, and the Exodus following the Passover, And the great Christian story, the lead up to the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus, which is set at Passover. As part of this, I've recently rewatched Joseph, King of Dreams, the direct-to-video prequel, to use that TV guide word, to the acclaimed film, The Prince of Egypt. One of the things which strikes me most about the Joseph story occurs just before Joseph makes himself known to his brothers. Judah, one of the older brothers, and over 20 years earlier, the one who had come up with the bright idea to sell Joseph to the slavers rather than kill him, pleads for Joseph to take and punish him instead of the youngest brother, Benjamin. The reason Judah gives the man who turns out to be his long-lost brother Joseph is that losing Benjamin would kill their father Jacob. In other words, it would be more than Jacob could bear. In the same way, I believe to the very core of my being that we will all be reconciled to God eventually, the God I know, the God who sent Jesus, doesn't give up on us. And the thought of losing even one of God's children to an eternity of fire and brimstone is more than the God I know could bear. I suspect that many of you have the same experience of God. As Lutheran minister Nadia Boltz-Weber, the author of Pastrix, has written, "The Christian faith, while wildly misrepresented in so much of American culture, is really about death and resurrection. It's about how God continues to reach into the graves we dig for ourselves and pull us out, giving us new life in ways both dramatic and small." I began this message by noting that in addition to being Easter, today would have been Joyce's birthday. I would like to close by sharing a song with you. Joyce and I first learned about this song from our friend Kim Williams around 30 years ago. And as I recall, his opinion back then seemed to be that, well, rather like Billy Joel's River of Dreams. You all remember that one? In the middle of the night. All right. You know, which he said kids loved because it was a healing song. And rather like that one, this is also a healing song. What I know is that since Joyce's death, it has poured balm on my grief more than once. I'll play it for you, partly because I'm not so vain that I think I can outsing Carly Simon, and partly because of the song's structure. It begins wistfully, plaintively, and is almost supplicatory before it evolves into a canon, or round if you prefer, which acquires all the force of a mantra. And if things go well, let me get it set up here. I couldn't find my copy of the CD, but so this will have to do.
I've been doing a lot of thinking about growing older and moving on. No one wants to be told that they're getting on and maybe going away for a long, long stay. Immortal, and death is only a horizon. Life is eternal, and
It is an essential part of the Christian witness that life is eternal and love is immortal. In the name of Jesus our Christ, Amen.